So let me just introduce. I have introduced a couple of my friends, but these awesome guys, the whole team, are my family. So Ramesh is the boss. he is a multi-talented person. I don't want to introduce you as you wrote your bio, Ramesh. He's a great friend, and he has very creative ideas. And well, luckily he has John and Andrew and everybody who are really, really good to make something special. And well, they have created a very, very interesting way of building for people who are not builders, who are not coders. Everything just you click a button and everything is there. And it is perfect for teachers, in my opinion. So I'm very happy to be in the team. And that's, well, the rest you will see. It all speaks for itself. Thank you, Ramesh.
All right, thanks, Annabelle. I'm going to share a video, and everyone was, I'm assuming, are seeing it on their screen. And if there's any problem, just let me know, and I'll try to fix it. So I'll go through the video and pose at various places and talk about what we are seeing. So to explain what we are doing, the first thing we'll do is to show you the end result of content that was created, you know, during pretty much like the duration of this meeting that we are having here. Okay, so within an hour or so, let's see what we can create, okay, with the right tools. All right, so I'm going to start the video showing the end results first so that you get a sense of the end product. And then in the second part, we'll show you how the environment, you know, emerged. And so let's start there. So we are going to start with end results. It's like in a cooking show, you are just going to watch, you know, the food at the end, in the beginning. Okay, that's what we are going to make. And then we'll show the process. So I'm clicking on play here. And the first thing that we'll show is like the landscape that we created, okay? And I'm going to post the video as along the way, as I said. So, here we are trying to show you how easy it is to change seasons in your, you know, let's say you create a landscape, okay? And now you just want to change the season. Of course, that's going to impact every leaf of a tree and, you know, the whole landscape. And we have implemented a little object called the theme changer that allows you to go through the various seasons in this case and to click on a button, and that would change all the necessary textures, so it changes the ambience of the whole environment. This is like a little something that we thought is visually compelling to watch, so that's why I thought I started with this. Okay. Now we are like, I've clicked on a button while doing the recording, of course, and we went back to the to summer, and all the trees were green, etc. And I'm now walking into a building that we created in that scene, and I'm going to show you the kind of content that was deployed. And so let's watch this. I'm going to pause and talk about more things as we come up. So one of the things that you can see here is that you can see displays, you can see signs, you can see that there are furniture that has been deployed already. And we are in a building where, you know, we can actually walk around, and it's quite a big building, as you would see, as you will see. So here the task for the team when we started the meeting, that was actually last Friday. So during that hour, we just started it. Okay, let's make a museum. and we'll make a museum about non-fungible tokens, and that our students can come and meet us and talk and watch the various pieces of art, and so that's what we were doing. The other thing is that's I think a strength of our approach is that you can inject all that information very quickly by just typing the URLs of the images or just typing in text. I didn't expect the video to have so many blockies here on my machine, but if you can, if there's any issue with the clarity of videos, just let me know. So for example, here, I'm just showing what the painting is and provided some information about this painting. All this information can just be added very quickly in this environment. This next series of frames of the video, I'm showing how you can add text to signs. So in this building, we have deployed like a 3D sign that we just placed in this building. And we are typing the title of a talk that we might want to give in this space. Okay. So I just type in what we are going to talk about. And the subject of this talk could be, the insane prices of NFT art, okay, by Professor Scribbler. Well, the thing is, for each and every object that we have, it's as I just showed just right now, a few seconds back, if you click on these, on the border of these images, you can get like a blue dialog box. In fact, I'll show you. Let me just go back just a little bit and show you this part, but I wanted to show you how to add images. Just look at the blank picture in the background where you have this R logo. R stands for Resmiller, it's the name of our system. But when you click on that image, you get the opportunity to enter information about what you want to display there. And you can either type a texture UUID, or you can type in a URL of that image, and it appears, so you don't need to do a lot of complicated things. Okay. And this is just an example of adding text to the little labels. And you might be thinking, but how did that label get placed there? Well, our approach, our tool allows you to do this. Okay. And now I want to give you an idea of what the tool looks like. If you look at the bottom right of the picture, you can see on the floor, you can see a button. It looks like a button. It's got an on and off sign on it. When you click on that button, you sign into the application, as it were, and you have lots of tools that becomes available to you. You can actually select from a menu whether you want to place grids on the floor, and you can have all kinds of grids. You have like the pillar that you see, that's a grid. The pictures on the floor, that's a grid too. And when you place objects, it just snaps to various places on the grid. So everything that you construct in this world is mathematically precise. You're not fiddling and moving things about and trying to judge. I mean, if you want to do that, you of course have the freedom to do that too, and not get guided by the grids. So here I just turned off the lights and just wanted to demonstrate, in this application, I just wanted to add some light source to my 3D building. And I just opened up, what we call the Composer app. And that menu appeared because I clicked on that on and off button that we showed on the floor just a few minutes back. And you see all the various categories of objects that you can see, okay? So let's just like suspend belief for a moment and just look at this. I've I know that there are light sources in a specific, you know, category of objects. I just went in and picked an object, which is like a cube here. And I'm going to place it here on top of this pillar, which on this 3D grid. And I can interact with that object, you know, just by clicking on the icon on the top right corner of this light source. I can specify all kinds of things, like the range of the light source. We can specify a lot of parameters, you know, the colors of the light and everything. And just remember all these different objects that we pick, you know, from this menu and place in this world and deploy it any way we can, all in order to create that experience, that scene, all that can be saved in a file. And this file, it exists as a note card or as a folder of note cards. You know, you can share that with your friends or other instructors, other teachers who might want to reuse them. So we have, you know, one stage of reusability that can happen here just by sharing, you know, those scenes. So now I will start backing out of, you know, the end product, and we'll start looking at how these tools function. Okay. So we have to talk about how the menu that you saw gets populated. It's kind of a very interesting concept. It's like that menu is actually a dynamic menu in the sense, in the following precise sense. It is able to detect objects that is organized in what we call modules. So if you see those little prims, those little boxes on the ground, these are you know, the various categories of objects that we saw in that menu in the top left corner. And in each of these categories of objects, you have a set of you know, other objects, but I want to show you here how these items in the menu gets populated. Okay, so we have these boxes of content. Think of it like a prim, and inside those prims you have objects. Okay, so in this one, let's pick the furniture example, and I am showing you inside that object what's available. And we have a whole range of furniture. Okay, we have desks, of different kinds of desks, you know, like bookcases or surfaces or separations that you can use in your virtual office or in your virtual classroom. And you know, those objects become available through the HUD menu. And we'll see a few examples, but I want to show you like the whole range of items that you can have. Next to that object that contains furniture, we have rooms. You can actually, instead of having tables and chairs, you can have blocks of rooms. You can have that you can connect together in order to create buildings, okay? So again, I'm just going to show a lot of examples of categories of objects that we have. We have like seating, you know, category. We have, let me just go back a little bit, I was too fast here. So like if I pause here, at the center, you can just after the print that contains blocks of buildings, you can see seating. And in seating, you have all kinds of sofas, you know, cushions that you can just pick and place at one click. And you have those like square tiles that we can use to create like pathways. And we have what we call hexatiles. All that is kind of interesting because each of these objects are kind of intelligent in a way. They've got like a certain behavior. So when you pick, let us say, a hexatile from the menu, you can just connect them to the others and create like a bee, it's not a web, but you know what I mean. It's like a connect all these hexagons together very quickly, and you can create a lot of different designs using those primitive objects. And we don't stop there. We can also create, you know, like this whole surround. If you have mountains, same principle. You can select from a range of different types of mountains, and you can just, you know, click and you have your mountain. So you have to think in terms of how much creativity goes into the design of all these different objects that goes into these modules. But wait, there is more. those objects, those modules, just think about it. It can also be created by anyone else. We have a kit which is that allows anyone, you know, instructors or anyone who wants to create their own objects, they will be able to do it. And they will also be able to put it in those prims, and that HUD will be able to see, you know, everything that's contained in those modules, okay? So we have a couple of scripts that somebody can drop into any object that they want to turn into one of these objects that can be placed at a click anywhere in a scene. You know, we will provide that toolkit so that people can actually capture the various behaviors they want for these objects, okay? Now you can ask the question, well, if you have 1 million modules, you know, everyone is happy and creating their modules, and you know, how can we make sure that this HUD doesn't get crowded with items? That's where these enabled buttons come in at the bottom of these modules. So if you buy 100 modules containing all kinds of content that you want to use in your world, then you can enable and disable them. So in order to control, you know, the number of items. All these are really little details that I'm saying, but it just shows, you know, that we have a, you know, really thought out the whole process of how to capture good content, curate them into those modules, and make it available, you know, to instructors and to people who can focus on the subject matter. Okay, so quick summary here: we started with the end product, showed you what was created, and then now I am diving and showing you the nitty gritty details of the tool. Okay, so here I'm going to sign into the Composer app, just again to show at another level of abstraction what happens. So when you sign into the Composer app, you click on this blue button. You know, you can see the label at the bottom. So I get a menu, and I have selected the layout tools, and now I'm going to select you know, various kinds of grids, and I'm going just to place it on the ground there just to demonstrate. So as you can see, it just popped up, you know, where I want it to be. And on, you know, I just moved my cursor to this place, and I'm just clicking, and all the rotation and adjustments for things to snap where they need to be, all that is done automatically. And you know, I'm just going through the HUD to show all the various different kinds of objects that you have access to. Again, you have multimedia, furniture, square rooms, etc. Now I'm going to just select like a block and place it on this grid, and you will see, okay, here we have a building, you know, already, okay? And just to show that we also thought about granularity of content, okay? So you can build content using like building blocks, but what if someone really wants to make something very, you know, in a lot of details? So we provide the option. It's like we are simulating Minecraft in OpenSim. And people can, you know, use blocks to create, you know, buildings. So if you want like a special kind of gate that you want to add in front of your building that you use our blocks, you can do that and customize. And the last few frames, I just showed how you can add text very quickly too. So now, after showing you, that was too fast, a summary of you know, the end product, and then a summary of the Composer app, and how you have the HUD and the list of objects that you can pick and place and to create your scene. Now I'm going to share with you how we just captured this live, the interactions with you know, the team members to create this whole campus. Okay, so that was the start of the meeting last Friday, and let's watch it unfold. So the first thing that was done, the mountain range was picked and placed by John, and John is working on, you know, landscaping. Okay, so we don't need to fiddle away with terrain tools now. You can just have everything mesh. You create your terrain, and you have you know, the landscape emerging in the background. And you can notice that Annabelle, our architect, is building this you know, 3D building here, and she's just placing the blocks around. And all this is happening in parallel. While John is inside the building, he's not actually doing much inside the building. He's focused on the outside, but you know, you get the point, because he has his own view. I was recording this as a third person, and the avatar, they will be located wherever, you know, they happen to be. But just by coming around, you know, you can build anywhere. So Annabelle is adding, you know, more features and more structures to her building, and we can discuss live, because now you're not fighting with the tools. We spend much more time talking about what we want to build rather than fighting with the tools. Okay, and here you can see Andrew. He's like planting trees, you know, and as I said, all these various like fauna, when they are being added, you don't need to make them look organic, because we have already you know, inbuilt behaviors in those objects. They can be randomized, you know, according to rotation, size, etc. So as the environment emerges, it looks, you know, organic. And if I pause the video here, you can see in the right of this frame, you can see Ludo is actually, you know, working on placing the furnitures, you know, using his Composer app. And so everyone is working in parallel, building something, except me. I was just filming and trying to get the best shot I could. And you can see Andrew is playing with, you know, adding grass, etc. All these trees, etc., have animated leaves, and you can, you know, basically what you're seeing here is an example of our approach. Just imagine if every designer or instructor start, you know, having an input in what they want to see in those categories of objects, then we will end up with, you know, far, far better results. Here I was just, I had some time, so I was trying to add a welcome sign to this building. So I just placed, you know, these two grids here, and I'm placing the welcome 3D text on this building. So that's here. And I'm going to move my camera around so that you can see, you know, the building that Annabelle has already built. It's already looking very, very complicated now. It's got lots of rooms, etc. All these objects, when you see this big stone rotating, that's because Andrew is selecting it, you know, the stone from his app, and moving it around. And now John is testing the changer, the texture, the theme changer functionality of these scenes. remember all these trees, etc. You can actually change the textures, as I mentioned in the beginning, from any seasons, etc. You know, and you know, just demonstrating that. Let's see, as this video is unfolding, it's supposed to move forward. I just want to make sure that I didn't pause it for too long. Okay. Just stop me if you have any questions, or if Annabelle can start collecting questions, please do so. And here I am just adding some more signs outside the building, you know, again, thinking about, I'll be adding some pictures and signage for our little museum about non-fungible tokens. Inside those various rooms now, let's have a view of what's happening inside. Same principle, you know, we have an instance of the Composer app, and we are adding content. Ludo is, you know, fine-tuning the locations of his furniture. Now John has shifted from building the landscape, and now he's just building the path around the building, just for a few moments back. I'm still fiddling with adding more 3D signs. So as I'm walking around and filming, John is like building all these steps so that I can walk over them. And we'll have a quick run through this building, because I think that building looks nice. You know, it was as I said, the look and feel of the building. You know, it's just an example. If somebody wants to have another style of the building, we can just create another module, or we can help another designer who already has some ideas about how things want to look alike. You know, we can do that. So the building was so large that I had to really accelerate the video clip so that you get to see, you know, the few rooms that was happening. So here, John is just checking the various textures for the path as well, because you have the possibility of changing the texture of floors as well, not just, actually any object, not just, you know, the fauna. Now it's we are reaching the end, and you know, everyone was relaxing. And at the end of the meeting, we had a big you know, museum, and everything was ready for your classroom. So a few key points here that I want people to take home. Once we spend some time, enough time designing tools for content creation, there are a whole lot of opportunities for automating processes that take time. One example would be, you know, snap to grid, snap to object. Those actually make things, it just, every 10% time that you shave off on one operation that you do, and when you look at all the very series of steps that you need to create content, you are actually the speed of construction is increasing tremendously, just compounding.
And that's why,
yes,
there is a question. It's about shadows of the avatars as they walk, if we could add them. But I think that is just, you answer the question, please.
All right. Okay. So we did not add the shadows, you know, for the avatars. That's a viewer feature. So we could do this. And I'm actually going to try to share my screen on... to share another, let me share my live. I'm going to stop this sharing the video and share something else. I'm going to share the viewer, because it's always better to show and tell rather than just explain. So let me know if you can see what I'm seeing, which is, I don't know why I'm sleeping. I'm usually not that lazy. I'm trying to stand up. Okay. All right, so let me try to stand. Okay. Hey, stand up, Ramesh. Okay, I don't know. I don't want to fight with the viewer, but I can show you that if I'm going to switch on, it's a viewer feature, okay? So we don't have anything to do with this. If we go to graphics and I turn shadows on, okay, so let me click okay, and now you have shadows. So is there any other question? So the shadow is just part of the viewer. It's just that we don't use them when we are doing recording for for educational purposes. We want our content to appear crisp and clean, so that we and also the recording is much faster that way. You know, it just increases the frame rate by a lot. Okay, so that answers this question. But you can see that this environment exists, okay? We did not lie, and here it is. And here they are. And these are the modules that we used. Okay. And you can sign in into the environment here to get the menus, and you can just select from the various categories, etc., to get your content. So basically, is there any question before I can continue on the whys and what and how we can get more help from the teachers and the community? Is there any questions that people want to ask at this time? Please feel free. That's a good opportunity for you guys to ask questions. If you did have questions, try to create one right now.
There are no questions in chat, not yet.
Okay. All right. So I can continue about what I was saying in terms of these modules here and how important this is. If you think of a I'm trying to find a good example. It's a bad example, it's not very nice, but if you have like a razor, I mean, that's like a kind of a main analogy. You have like this device that you hold in your hand, like it's, and then you put the cartridges in, for the razor blade. You can have a whole different kind of cartridges to use. When you use this to shave, basically, you need more cartridges, more razor blades. But here our razor blade is all these modules, and the Composer app is like the recipient, the razor. That's the application that actually will be able to detect all these modules, okay? So by providing the toolkit for instructors, for designers, well, I don't think instructors would want to be involved in this, but I guess it's important for them to have an input to the design of objects that would go in. Then designers can package their creations in those modules, and this Composer app will just pick them up from these objects here, make it available, and we have the whole power of the Composer app to create all these various content that we see here, very rapidly. And I think the creativity will come in the design of these objects that goes into these modules, okay? We spent a lot of time to design these interactive texts, for example. We can these objects are actually quite powerful in the sense that you can change the font of these all these objects, for example. So if you can change, I hope you can see this. If you can't, just let me know. You can change the color of the background. Let me change this to brown, and I say, okay, I want my text to be white or black or whatever. Oh, I can change. I clicked on the wrong thing here. Text color, okay? So let me go to, if I want red on brown, I can do this. So all of these different items are deeply interactive. And when you are done with your creation, you can just save it. Okay, you just click here, you save, and you save it as a note card, and you can load it from the same application. So you would just click here, and you will find a file that captures the whole scene, and you can actually just load it, basically. So what we have done here, we are actually attacking the problem of content creation and the speed of creation and the amount of detail that you can inject into an environment, the amount of interactivity that you can inject into the environment. And all that can be saved. It's kind of, in a file that you can share with your peers, okay? If you want to sell the file because you have assembled your scene in a very intelligent way that others won't be able to do that, yeah. So you're free to, you might be able, even that can become a commodity to sell. So there are many different levels to look at this. And we are working on modules for things like non-player characters, so that when you want to add non-player characters in that scene, you would just sign in, go to your HUD menu, and select the various types of characters that you need and place it in your environment. And those characters have, just like you can click on a text object here and be able to change its data and its content and its the way it looks. For the characters, you can change its behaviors as well. And all these characters, we're also working, and connecting it to Watson API, the AI engine. So you could talk to these characters and ask them questions, and they'll get answers from the web or from, whatever database that you can try. So we are going to inject artificial intelligence functionality into our environments, and that people will be able to use, as easily as just picking content from the menu and placing it here. Still no questions. I'm hoping that I'm not going like into abstract la la land, that it's hard to ask questions. Okay, but that's the kind of approach that we are choosing. Okay, for creating these objects. We have a lot of videos that we shared on YouTube that kind of tracks our progress throughout all these iterative design steps. Initially, we had different separate apps that we created for different functions, but then we discovered a way where we only need one composer app now. And separate modules. It kind of simplifies everything further. So now people don't need to go on the market and buy separate applications for different things. What they will need to do is buy the Composer app and then buy the cartridges, the modules, those little objects here separately, and that they will be able to just raise on their land. And that Composer app will detect, and they will be able to use them for creating whatever content they need. So Let us remember, there's something that I'm very, very proud about. It's the team that we have. It's we all, you know, are doing doing incredible things, actually, overcoming a lot of challenges, you know, from the technical side, from the financial side, from all kinds of sides you can imagine. And still we were able to come and achieve what we have. And I think that it was important at this stage to come up with examples that allows OpenSIM developers to see the possibilities of what they have created, okay? The level and granularity of content and the design of how we are actually making this happen and our strategy of automating anything that's automatable to speed up production of content without hurting the possibility for people to create anything that's very fine grained and very particular to what they want. I think it's a very significant goal that we have achieved here, and I hope we can continue to serve you, this community, over the, you know, the future, as long as I can, you know, generate, you know, funding every time and push the boundaries. We really hope to make this OpenSIM environment, you know, one of the best that environments for creating the metaverse. It's got all the various kinds of important stuff that's, according to me, is very important for the metaverse. I know a lot of people hate to use it and they have distorted its meaning, but I think that we all should gang together and support each other and support the developers of OpenSIM so that we can continue to improve everything and make things happen. So we have 10 minutes for more questions. Is there any question that has come up yet from anyone?
Yeah, it's about self-funding, Nelly asked, actually.
Well, if you want to know the real story of how I'm self-funding, I might say I gamble and I make money. And I write grants, which is kind of a lottery situation. So sometimes you get money from grants, but you have to be extremely creative. So you try to make money off the stock market as well, and you try to get all these different things happen. And it's incredibly difficult, really, because we did not want to really go out there first thing we have to see what our audience base is, how much they can afford, and how much change we can make to their work process and environment. And then decide, you know, how we can have a sustainable effort. Our primary aim is to really explore the use of virtual environments, not only from a community building perspective, this is kind of obvious, but also from the perspective of how can we add productivity tools inside this environment? How can we invent new ways of instructions? How can we explain mathematical concepts more easily? I have a few clips where I try to explain the nature of logarithmic functions or exponential graphs just by using cubes and try to visualize, how fast an exponential function grow. And I think that it's the power of 3D for data visualization, for example, is definitely there. And we are ready to support all kinds of applications, from language teaching, which is more direct because you want to immerse people in an environment, and we can do that. And we can have you know, the nonclear characters that can do the translate languages and interact with people, etc. So we are hoping that we can address all these different communities, all these different subject matter experts. And the main thing is, if they get value from virtual worlds, and if they don't have to overcome too many barriers, then that's good for our vision in terms of how we can use those 3D environments. As I said, our approach is really not to design virtual environments kind of separate from the web. You know, we do want to facilitate the injection of information from the web into those 3D worlds easily too. So I gave an example, I think, earlier on in the conference of how we can have, we have an app called the Pano Cube, where if someone want to immerse their students in a real world setting, anywhere, you know, in the world, basically, you just type in the address of that location, and we gather images from Google Maps and create like an all surround, you know, virtual version of that place. That's one example of how we are injecting real world information into virtual world information as well. So frankly, we think that at this stage, we are offering in terms of, you know, concept, design, applications, we are really trying hard to push the envelope forward. And I do spend a lot of time looking around and looking around at what's happening in, you know, what Facebook is doing for their 3D worlds, etc. And I can say that I think one of our issues is that our work, and I see that, you know, for many other OpenSim efforts or even virtual world Second Life efforts, it doesn't get out there as much as it should. So I hope that we can get some support from everybody in terms of, you know, outreach and sharing our videos, etc., or even liking them, and try to fight the algorithms, just to, because that's what everybody does, and they have tools to automate it. And for people creating good content on YouTube, it's really not easy to actually be able to make things work. It's not like I'm saying that we have to do it in a very artificial way. It's that the whole nature of the attention economy now is kind of really obtuse. I mean, you can watch a lot of video clips, and it's really designed to trigger the primitive brain. And anything that's more intellectual or educational, it's harder to get access or to get the visibility. But we can do one little thing. I try on my end every time I see someone post a video on Twitter, you know, if Nelly's posting something or anybody else, I always try to increase reach from my end. So I think if we support each other, we can actually make things happen much faster. And our next step really is to make all these tools that we are building available to as many people as possible. Now that we have streamlined the design, I think that it becomes easier for us to maintain the systems when it's out. We don't have too many apps to maintain now. You know, we just have one composer app and just new modules that's coming in. So we are always looking for new 3D designers, modelers, anything. You know, we encourage people to contact us, and if they have any ideas, you know, for creating good content, we really want more, you know, different types of fauna, trees, etc., flowers, you know, good looking 3D characters, anything you want, really. And it's just a matter of packaging them and using our kit. Takes a few minutes, put it in the modules, and we can start sharing those modules. So Are there still no questions, Annabelle?
No questions, but a very, very nice answer from Nelly.
Okay, so this video, if it's recorded, just let me know. I'll try to share it on my end as well. And let's just keep the fight going, because, you know, and in the background, I don't know if you are watching my video, you can see like molecules in those different frames. That's actually a snapshot of molecules that I created using the same approach. You know, one module can contain like atoms and like 3D models of you know, people who do chemistry are familiar with kits that are used to create molecules of various kinds. So you use the same approach. You have one module with objects that can be connected together to create all this. So you have like behind me these carbon atoms that's connected in a, you know, that shows the molecular shape. So we have a generic approach. We have our apps, and we've tested everything. It works. Next step for us is to start making everything available to people and distribute them as much as we can with minimum friction as possible. All right. So if there is no other question, I'm here though. I mean, you can still continue the conversation. If people want to contact me personally, I can give you my personal address that I'm going to. Well, I think Annabelle has it, but let me see how. I'm looking for the chat window on Zoom. Where's the chat? Okay, I see it here. All right. So this is my personal Gmail address. I'm not going to give you the CEO address. Okay. So this one here, we are among like family members, really. So just send it to me. If you want to help me out, reach out to me, you know, just let me know.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much, Ramesh. This was very important for all of us, I think. Those here in Zoom, those that are currently in the stream on YouTube, and those that will be watching this. By the way, if you want to get more people to watch your videos, the way to do it is to have game-like streamed, and that way it takes a while. Okay, at first it'll be maybe two or three people, but then it'll be more and the numbers will increase. And I think if you enjoy doing videos on YouTube, live streaming is also a good way to do it. Yes. So this is one way. It takes time until things get going, and you'll need to learn more about the algorithms that are changing now on YouTube. They have changed in the past year. They've changed things. So I guess they're changing them all the time to confuse people so they don't make too much money.
Yeah, now we have to spend time designing thumbnails with special attention to that.
Yeah, well, sometimes you have to do things, you have to kind of go around about to get to where you want to get to.
Yeah. All right, guys, I want to thank everybody. I want to thank John, Ludo, Annabelle, everyone who is here, Doris, everybody. So I'm going to sign off very soon, and I want to wish everyone a good weekend. So,
thank you. Great job. Thank you.
All right.